Hallelujah.
Amen.
When we listen to God's voice, He's going to always say things usually contrary to your thinking. You're here. Remember something. He's eternal minded, heavenly minded, righteous minded, holy minded. God is holy, be holy. Okay? His thoughts are always pure and virtuous and true and just and that which is perfect. His thoughts are always perfect because He's perfect. So when God showed me the other day, He says, you ask them and you tell them that I am waiting on them. That's the title today. God is waiting on you. Yeah. Yeah. For so long, we're looking for God to do something when He's done. The doing is now His life in you that's going to live through you. And until we really get that point inside of us that it's no longer I who live, but He who lives in us, then the work of the gospel is never going to have any power or effect on mankind. The church is teaching the ways of men now. There's so much compromising in the gospel today, it's watered down. God never said change this. He said don't, or I'll rebuke you. Oh. It says don't mess with my word. This is not a toy. It's not to be something to be used as a weapon against people, but against darkness. It's empowered you with the fullness of the power of His resurrected life. It's the living word. This is not a book of dead words. These are alive. And until you learn spiritually who you really are, you're going to walk in defeat instead of victory. It's time we learn what that word wait even means. See, God's waiting on us. It's amazing how He told me that the last couple days. He says, my church needs to wake up. Wait means to stay in place or remain in readiness or anticipation. Wow. Anticipating. See, God can't understand because He's ready to live His life through you. But are you ready to die so He can? Ooh, that got quiet. Are you ready to die to yourself so God can live? Because He's at the ready. He's in you. You need to let Him loose. Until something expected happens or for someone to arrive. They were waiting for the Messiah. Anyone may have spoken in Moses' day. There's another one coming like you. What did He tell David? You're always going to have somebody on your throne. They were waiting thousands of years for the Messiah. And then when He came, they rejected Him. See Him waiting, happening, something to arrive. To remain temporarily undone or neglected. The church has neglected what Christ has done. And the power He's given it. Yes, this is a tough message today. We have neglected our responsibility and our allegiance to Jesus Christ, our soon coming King. Because we spend so much time doing instead of following and obeying. He said the church has neglected Him. See, He says the church because we are a family of one. When one part of His church suffers, we all suffer because we don't have the effectiveness in the world that Christ created for His church. One church, endued with power from on high by the Holy Ghost. Oh, it gets worse. Let that job wait. How many people are procrastinating their journey with Jesus? Because they get so tied up with the affairs of the world. You get tied with family affairs and people's affairs and everybody's affairs but your own with Christ. Your job is singleness with God. Yes, we're a body of one, but every one of you has a calling and a responsibility to fulfill your destiny that God has put in your heart. So we've been waiting for God to do something when He already did. He's waiting on you to say, whatever it takes, get me and use me for your purposes for which you predestined before the world began. Amen?
Amen.
See, because He knew this. He's been waiting. Because it says in Isaiah, there was no God before me, there'll be none after me. He's always on the job. He never sleeps, He never slumbers. Psalm 121, amen? Waiting, the word waiting. One that serves or is in attendance. Matthew 18. When two or more are gathered in His name, He's there in your midst. He's in attendance right now. He's waiting on you. He's waiting on all of you. He's here. He can't go anywhere. He's omnipresent. He's God eternal. He's always been here. The Spirit of God hovered over the face of the earth in the first chapter of Genesis, and it's not gone anywhere. He's always in attendance. He's always with us. He never leaves us. He never forsakes us. He's always on the ready to use you for His glory. But if you're too busy waiting for God to do something, He's waiting on you to say, "Here I am, you lead me and guide me. You've empowered me to go out and be a world changer.
Oh, yes, the Lord.
You've empowered me to go out and share the power of salvation that can set every captive free and heal every wounded soul." He's here for that. He's here to seek and to save every soul that's lost. But until we start putting everything aside that interferes with your walk with God, and I mean everything, there's no more time, church. The active one that waits in the waiting in attendance as on a king or other person of royalty. Oh. Look how quiet God. There's only one King of Kings and Lord of Lords. But the vision I got yesterday, He's yea tall, we're this tall. We're dressed the same way He is. As a priest and a king. He's the Most High Priest. We have a more powerful priesthood than the Old Covenant. Ours is bought with the blood. Ours is sealed with the Holy Spirit. And it says in Hebrews, it's a far better covenant that we have and a more powerful one. Because it seals your eternal redemption. It seals your name in the book of life with His blood. You are now sealed with His very life, the Holy Spirit, the living waters. You are now royal children of the Most High God. Don't go there in 1 Peter. In the second chapter it says, we are chosen and precious by God, being built up as a spiritual holy house and royal priesthood, holy nation of believers. You're being built up for that. When you read that in Peter, and you go to that second chapter, you are royalty, folks. How are you going to walk knowing who you are until you see yourself as a royal vessel? Precious and chosen by God. Ordained by God. Your royalty. How is God going to show you who you are until you see yourself that way? If you don't see yourself as royalty, that means you haven't forgiven yourself for where you've been. You're still talking about where you've been instead of where God's going to take you. You're still living in your past instead of your future. Be future-minded, or you're going to be carrying around the past the rest of your days. I don't know how long I used to sit there and blame myself for all my mistakes, and God finally whacked me one time. Really, He convicted me so bad. He says, "Why do you talk about stuff that I don't have a record of?" He said, "You teach people all the time. Once they've repented, my blood erases that. I don't have a record of it. Why do you? If you sit around, I made this mistake, that mistake, this mistake. I did this wrong. I did that wrong. Yeah, pigs can fly." Because that's how unimportant it is to God. How are you going to see yourself as a chosen, precious son and daughter of the Most High God, dressed in robes of royalty from the Heavenly Father? He gave His Son in His clothing, and He put it on you.
Amen.
Oh, hallelujah. You need to see yourself as royal children of the Most High God, a royal and holy priesthood.
Hallelujah.
That's who you are in His eyes.
Amen.
Stop listening to things that tell you you're something different. I don't care what you heard when you were a kid or what people told you. If I went by what people told me as a kid, I would have ended my life a long time ago. I mean, you have no idea what people said about me, and rightfully so. I was that evil. I was that bad. I was that lost. I was resident evil. I took evil to a whole nother level. But I had a merciful God in heaven that says, "I'm going to make you a vessel of honor again. I'm going to make you a vessel of honor. You can't, but I can, because I am God. I'm going to give a new spirit and a new heart in you. I'm going to put my life in you. And then you're going to go out and tell people there's forgiveness and salvation for all who call upon the name of the Lord Jesus Christ." Amen? All who call upon Him become royal children of God. You need to start telling your Christian brothers and sisters that are walking around with their head drooping on the ground out here that they're royalty, and with royalty comes the blessing of Abraham. And until you see yourself that way, how are you going to believe for the blessings of Abraham unless you see yourself as a royal child of God? Made worthy by the blood of Jesus Christ. Chosen and precious. Oh, hallelujah. I am going to preach myself so happy today. I just might leave the place. I might just go and take a visit. Ah, hallelujah. Don't go there. Revelation 5:1-5-6. To him who loved us, washed us from our sins in his own blood, has made us kings and priests to his God and Father. To him be glory and dominion forever and ever. Amen. Now, settle it in your heart today that you are a priest and king and a royal chosen vessel of God. Amen. Forgiven and washed in the blood. See, because when he starts saying things more than once, he's telling you something. Because he knows we're a little slow on our hearing and thick in our head. Just saying. Well, not Dan, but the rest of us. So, I'm just saying. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. But that's who we are. It says so. This is your love letter from your heavenly Father through his Son. He made you royalty. How are you going to have the abundant life until you know it? How are you going to be healed spiritually, mentally, emotionally, physically, financially? All the years restored to you, like it says in Joel, unless you know you're a royal child and all you do is receive and speak the word of acceptance. Lord, I receive your blessed abundant life. I receive the blessings of Abraham. And speak it over yourself every day. You have the power in your tongue. Amen?
Amen.
Amen?
Amen.
Proverbs 18. Your tongue is such a weapon against darkness. And when you know how to use it properly, like I said, demons will flee from you. Amen. They won't even want to be in the same city as you. Mm. When your eyes are open in the morning and you say, Lord Jesus, I bless you in this day, every demon that's in the sound of that voice should run from you. Oh my God, he or she's awake again. See, once you know who you are, he'll go play somewhere else. I'm telling you, I met the devil. He's big, he's bad, he's ugly. And he's powerful. But the one who lives in me disarmed him and rendered him powerless. And he's got to bow at my master's name. Amen. See, I know that. Amen. So he can come play. And what I'm going to tell him, it is written. Jesus rules and reigns. He disarmed you. He put you under my feet. You stay off my stuff, out of my marriage, out of my ministry, out of my life, out of my finances, out of my walk with God. You get out of my way in the name of Jesus. Amen. Because I rule and reign with Christ. I don't rule and reign with no people. I don't need an army. I got one. His name's Jesus. Amen?
Amen.
Oh, hallelujah. We're going to have church today. Verses 20 and 21. This is so important that you realize the power of your tongue today. Let the Holy Ghost lead your tongue and not your emotions, your feelings, your heart. Give the Holy Spirit permission to speak words of power and authority and victory. A man's stomach will be what? Satisfied from the fruit of where?
In his mouth.
Everything you speak is what your life is going to be. From the produce of his lips he shall be filled. Death and life are in the power of the tongue, and those who love it will eat its fruit. Oh. I've said it before, and I'm going to say it until I go home to be with Jesus, until everybody gets it that I talk to in this whole world. What you speak is what's going to be. The same voice that said, let there be light, is in you. That's some power. The same voice that put the stars, the sun, and the moon all in its place and keeps it moving. The same voice that spoke fish into the sea and birds into the air and animals on dry land is in you. That's what comes off your tongue. So what you speak is what's going to be. If you speak a life of depression, of defeat, of discouragement, of sickness, of poverty, of lack, you want to speak the things of the curse of the law, you go right ahead. But it is your life that will suffer. It is never God's will for you. Never in a million years. All that false teaching in the church, I heard it when I was young. Oh, God just wants you to walk around and be humble and just accept a little bit that you have. That'll make you a better servant. Don't say it. thank you, Lord. He caught me there. That is the biggest bunch of manure on the planet. Nowhere in here does he tell you to be broke, busted, and disgusted, sick, and miserable. If somebody can show that to me, praise God. Because you can. I know you can. I spent some time in this book, and it's not there. God says, I came, and I became all the curses of those words on the cross so they can't have you. I came and defeated Satan so you could have the abundant life. You are now a new creation in Christ. God takes no pleasure in anybody suffering. Do we suffer? Of course we do, because life happens. I pulled a muscle on my neck the other day, but I kept praying until it got better today. That was my fault. I was in such a hurry here the other day to clean things up. I grabbed something that was way too heavy, and boy, I felt it pull all the way up. I went, why don't I slow down some days? Because he was trying to tell me, take your time, it's all right, you're going to get there on time. But we get in a hurry with life, and that's when things go wrong, because when you're in too much of a hurry, he's here, you're already going down the steps, and he ain't told you to go down those steps yet. He can't order your steps unless you're willing to listen. He's waiting on you to listen. Because he's always going to lead you in what? Triumph. He's always going to lead you in the ways of peace. He's always going to lead you in the ways of prosperity and a hope and a future and love and joy and peace in the Holy Ghost.
Amen.
That's your life in Christ, and anything else should be unacceptable to you. Sometimes we got to fight for what we want in the Spirit.
Yes.
We got to make it says when you've done all you can do, you stand. And you look darkness in the eye and say, I've had enough of you and your nonsense. Now bow and get out of my life in Jesus' name. Why are you not speaking it? Because you speak the circumstance instead of the answer to it. See, the answers to your circumstances are in this book. That's why we need to spend more time in it. Just saying. Yeah. Luke 10:19. Behold, I give you all power and authority to trample on serpents, on scorpions, and over all the power of the enemy, and nothing shall hurt you. 1 Peter 1:5, we are kept by the power of God. He doesn't say, I give you some power over some things. Does he? I give you all. I give you all. So anything that's contrary to those words, why would you speak them? Well, and then you use the word B-U-T. That means he didn't give you all power. Yeah. How's that one today? Yeah. When I was in there worshiping this morning, he said that pain in your neck was your fault. No, I did it. The devil didn't do it. It was me. I was in too much of a hurry, like I do sometimes. My mistake. But he says, it doesn't have to stay there. And then I just started praying in tongues and worshiping the Lord. And the next thing you know, I could lift my arm. I could move, because up until even last night, I could barely even lift it. Because every time I did, that strained muscle was hurting. So but the more I worshiped, the more I stood on the Word, the more I spoke the Word, the more I praised my soon coming King. I just kept magnifying and exalting, O El Shaddai, O Jehovah Rapha, my healer. And the more I praised Him, the more my arms started to move. The more I could do this and this, the more I could do this and this. And this morning, when I got out of bed, I could not. But after praising my God and worshiping Him for 20, 30 minutes, let me tell you, then I went out and made the chili.
Amen.
Because I'm always letting triumph.
Yes.
Never let a circumstance dictate your life. You're the one that has dominion. We have dominion.
Amen.
We're the church of glory. Amen. Hallelujah. Oh, hallelujah. Oh, my wife's having a good time back there today. Oh, thank you, Jesus. You know, I'm saying this because time is speeding up. You don't need to go there. You've all read this before. James 4:14-15. Whereas you do not know what will happen tomorrow, for what is your life? It's even a vapor that appears for a little time and then vanishes away. That's where he had me make that note this morning. Our King is returning soon. We need to make every day count. It says that in Matthew 6. Seek His kingdom, His righteousness first. All these things will be added unto you. Don't worry about tomorrow. Tomorrow will care for itself. It'll have enough troubles all its own. We have to be so Christ-centered and focused, circumstances can never dictate your life. Because if I let circumstances dictate my walk with God, I'd have quit about a year into it. No, I would have. Because after that initial grace period and stuff, and then when things really went south, and then the next thing I'm on bed with a broken back in an apartment in West LA going, what am I going to do now? And the Holy Spirit says, how are you going to make a living now, tough guy? Because I said yes, and I made my yes and no. That's why I tell all of you that all the time, don't do it. There's consequences to that. When you say yes to God, it's yes to God. It's not up for discussion after that. Because He'll hold you to your word. And I don't say that in a bad way. Be thanking Him that He will. Because God, He says, He'll keep you in His power in 1 Peter 1:5. The power of God will keep you. Stop trusting in your own power and rely on His. Amen? Oh, thank you, Jesus. But time is short. We need to start making the most of our lives for Jesus. Not for this world. You're not here to be people pleasers. You're here to be God pleasers. That's what we're here for.
Amen.
Amen.
Jesus, yes, Lord.
Look at the worship we had this morning. I almost fell down 4 times back there. Holy Ghost was just rolling and rolling and rolling. Amen.
Amen. Amen.
Hallelujah.
Thank you, Jesus. If you have your Bibles, turn to Mark 11. Remember what I said, death and life are in the power of the tongue. You are to use your tongue for God's glory and not yours. Because we can do so much damage with this fiery little bugger, can't we?
Yes, we can.
Yeah. And I don't think there's a person alive that hasn't made that mistake and we haven't repented for our words. I have. I don't know about anybody else. Because I know sometimes my tongue and my temper got the better of me. Even as a Christian, I said things I never should have said. And I've had to ask for forgiveness. Amen? Forgiveness is a great weapon. Because it heals you and sets you free. When you ask forgiveness from someone and they don't give it to you, it's okay. Because now your heart is right back to where it was with Christ before the offense happened. Okay, offenses should never fall on you. Like I said, if you get offended too easily, it means you're too thin-skinned. Just saying. Because let me tell you something. To serve Christ, you must have a thick skin and a soft heart. It's a hard combo. It is. It's a hard combination because people are humans. They do human stuff. And the ones that don't know Christ, they really do human stuff. And it's not usually very pretty. Oh, I know none of you have that problem, but I'm just saying from experience. Mark 11, 20 to 26. Now remember something, Jesus had just went out and cursed the fig tree. And you know, when I was studying this, what else did He do in that chapter? He cleansed the temple. When I was re-studying this yesterday, He showed me something. He said, I cursed the root. I cleansed the temple. Why? Because they weren't bearing fruit in the temple. They weren't worshiping. They were selling and making money and using usury. What is that? The thing unjust gain. What is that word for that? Yeah. The money exchanges were making more than they should have, and all that stuff. It was all greed. So cursing the fig tree, He showed me, and cleaning out the temple, He was cursing the root of everything that doesn't bear fruit. Remember what I said when you come in here, when you read that chapter, go back and study it out. You'll see the two are right linked together. And there's another thing, there's 3 things actually linked together, forgiveness. This is so important, that's why I tell people, don't read one line and make a teaching out of it. Don't read one sentence, okay, this is what it all means. No, read the whole part of the chapter, okay? Make sure you get before and after so you see what God's really saying to us by His Spirit. You see, so many people take out one line, and that's their whole teaching. No, it's from Genesis to Revelation. That's why I say read the whole book. Because a lot of what's in the New Testament is the Old Testament revealed. And we should be learning lessons from even those in the Old, but we should be more thankful than all those in the Old Testament, because we have so much more than they had. Okay? The fathers of your faith went through a lot of stuff to help usher in Jesus, okay? Just saying. So there's a lot going on in that chapter. Go back and study it. Now they came back out of town after He had already cursed the fig tree. And now in the morning as they passed by, they saw the fig tree dried up from the roots. Every plant that my Father's not planted will be uprooted in John, amen, 15. Everyone that does not produce fruit will be uprooted and thrown in the fire, amen. And Peter, remembering, said to him, Rabbi, look, the fig tree which you cursed has withered away. The power of the tongue. You have the same power as God in your mouth. You have His tongue. You are His voice piece down here now. So Jesus answered and said to them, have faith in God, for surely I say to you, whoever says, you're the whosoever, that's us, amen, says to this mountain, be removed and be cast into the sea, and does not doubt in his heart, but believes those things which he says will be done, he will have whatever he says. Therefore I say to you, whatever things you ask for when you pray, believe that you receive them. See, when you speak God's word to your circumstance, do you actually believe it's going to happen? Do you believe the manifestation of His promises in your life? When God says, I shall supply all of your need, and you say, Lord, I thank you, I decree and declare you're going to supply all of my needs. I'll never be begging bread, I'll never be forsaken, I'll never be put to shame. Do you believe it?
Amen.
Because unless you believe it, it won't manifest.
That's right.
You'll be waiting for God to do something. The word won't manifest until you believe it will.
Amen.
Until you speak it with the same authority Jesus spoke to that fig tree. But that fig tree is a warning to the church that doesn't produce fruit. Read the book of Revelation. You'll see what happens to the churches that don't.
Amen.
And you will have them. Now, this is what gives your words power. See, everybody quotes the first part of this, pray and you'll have what you ask for. Forget that Santa Claus list, okay? Ask for the things of God, and then you'll have the things of God.
Amen.
And whenever you stand praying, if you have anything against anyone, forgive them that your Father in heaven may also forgive you your trespasses. Not trespass, yes. But if you do not forgive, neither will your Father in heaven forgive you. Galatians 5, 6, faith works by love. Now, when things go on in your life, and it's not according to the word you're praying and believing, you need to ask God what's in your heart. You do. You do. Because you could speak words of faith all day long. You could speak that until Jesus comes back. But unless you confess Him as Lord and Savior, He ain't going to heaven. He's the only way in. But if you have stuff in your heart against this one, this one, this one, this one, and you're going, God, you don't understand. Well, yes, He does. I'm telling you something, your prayers aren't going to be answered. I'm going to tell you that right now. Because look how quiet it got, because I'm as guilty as anybody. Stuff gets in your heart, folks. It's okay. There's one who can heal it. But give the Holy Spirit permission to show you what's here. So you can look at every human being right now, no matter what they've done to you, and say, Lord, I have forgiven them. Because you've commanded me to, but you've given me the grace to. And if you're having a hard time forgiving somebody, ask for the grace. You know what will happen? God will melt your heart so quick. You'll love the person. You may not fellowship with them, but you'll love them. Okay? Because God says use wisdom and choose your friends wisely. Don't think you got the discernment to choose everybody that should be in your life. Because if that were happening, none of you would be here this morning. Amen? Because God has enabled you to see things clearly. But I'm telling you, you're not going to move the mountain. You're not going to pray and get results. If you have bitterness and unforgiveness and judgments towards any other human being, you don't have the right to. Judgment belongs to God alone, not us. Can you judge sin? You bet. If somebody's in sin and you're trying to help them and they don't want to change, you've done your part. But don't you dare judge the person. The sin may be evil. Tell them, hey, listen, what you're doing, there's consequences for that. I tell people all the time, you don't believe in the Ten Commandments, it's Old Testament, go ahead and break some. See what happens. See how well your life works out. Just saying. They're going to find out that written word still has a lot of power. Because they're going to go and say, he's going to say, 1 through 6, do you remember the first 6? You broke them all. And you never repented. And then you wonder why your life is miserable. That person that hurt you 12 years ago, you never really forgave them. You forgot about them. You put them out of your memory. You tried, but you're still angry inside. You still haven't really let go of them and given them to me. Not only will it have set you free, it'll set them free to be dealt with by God so He can heal them and deliver them from what made them so miserable. See, you don't understand something. When you forgive people, that gives the God of all love power to go to them. Because most people hurt other people because they're hurt to begin with. So the hurt's coming back out hurting others. So if you don't really forgive them, it keeps him, because now you've become the judge, from going to that person and healing them and saving them and delivering them. We hurt that person by not forgiving them. It means you don't really care and you don't really love them, and don't tell God you do, because you don't. Because you don't give God permission to heal that person. We don't know where they've been. We don't know why they're so miserable and so angry and why they hurt people. We don't know what happened to them in their childhood. We don't know what they've been through. We don't know how they got there. Everybody looks at drug addicts and alcoholics and all these other animals in the streets. Well, you're looking at somebody who was worse than all these people put together. But God changed me. So how can I turn around and go back out and judge any of them? I can. I pray for these drug addicts and alcoholics and gambling addicts and everything else to be set free. Because He's come to set everybody free. Not some people. He loves us all. That has to be you. He's waiting on the church to go back to walking in the power of love and forgiveness and mercy and compassion and understanding and long-suffering. As He has been with us, we are to be with others. Amen?
Amen.
Amen?
Amen.
Take a breath. When I talk about power of your tongue, that's why I say be careful with your words. And if you say something off the cuff, you're going to know it immediately. I shouldn't have said that. Bring it right back to Jesus. Give it right back to Him. Say, Lord, I never should have spoke those words. He'll erase them that quick. He'll take the power of them away. You can curse the root of ungodliness in a person's life, but they let it get burned up or not is not your job. You have the power to curse the roots of ungodliness. I pray every day that God curse the root of all this religiosity that's in the body of Christ, and it is leading people away from the power of Christ instead of into it. Because when you go back and read that Mark 11, you're going to see He cleansed out the temple after cursing the root, and they're tied together. That and the power of forgiveness, those three things are right there in Mark 11. You can't miss them if you take time to meditate on them. Let the Spirit show you what God's teaching us. We have to be merciful people, forgiving people, but walk in all discernment, wisdom, and godly understanding. Like I said, I just shared with somebody today. I said, look out for the past coming back into your life. Because some of it's trying to come back into my wife and I's life right now. And I prayed last night and I prayed this morning. He says, pray for them. I will lead you in this. Trust them not. Do I love them? You bet. Have I forgiven them? Sure, a long time ago. But when God tells me, trust them not, who knows what's in all people? Yeah. So when He tells you, love people, okay. But when He says, trust them not, that means use wisdom. He's given me a heads up before it even happens. Let me tell you something. If we learn to listen to God, we walk into a lot less walls. Them sharks wouldn't have any room to bite you and wound you and hurt you if we'd listen to God's ways. Because He knows what the devil's doing out there, because the devil works through people. It's not the other way around. The devil works through people, not the other way around. They don't work through the devil. Most of them don't even know they're owned by the devil. Yep. So, God will show you. The Spirit says, I'll show you things to come. He's going to warn you. Listen to the red lights when He puts one up. Don't be like your pastor and run right through them sometimes. I was standing there this morning, well, worshiping, I'm looking out the window. This guy goes flying through the light. Guess who was sitting there? A police officer. He was flying. And guess what? Those lights came on. He didn't make it to the gym down the street, okay? Because he was moving. And I mean, he was moving good. That was probably a red light, because the cop was sitting right there at the corner. He was going so fast, he never even saw him. I don't know how big that ticket's going to be, but it's going to be big. Don't get a ticket in life that you shouldn't have. Don't get a wound that you should never experience because you didn't listen to God tell you what's best for you. His ways are always better. His ways are always love, joy, and peace. Like I've said, we have to go back to the love, joy, and peace in the Holy Ghost life. We have to learn to walk like that. It says, guard your heart with all diligence, for from it flow the issues of life. Amen? You know how you guard your heart? You stay in Him and Him in you. Because He'll protect your heart. He'll show you who to trust and who not to trust. Be careful where you associate, who you associate with. Like I said, there's a lot of slick willies out there. They know the Bible, but they don't know its author. They know the Word. The devil knows the Word. But what he knows is, like I said, his keister is getting closer and closer to that lake of fire. He knows his days are numbered. That's why I use James today. Life is but a vapor. Folks, we got work to do. There's an urgency in heaven. Man, when I saw all the angels above us Friday night, we were worshiping in here, and they were dancing. They were so excited what God wants to do with us. Amen. Oh, hallelujah. And like I said, I'm going to keep preaching. You should be excited and expecting what God wants to do with you, in you, and through you, and for you. There's nothing He won't do for you. He died for you. How can you think there isn't anything He won't do with you when you would do for you when you look at that cross? Those thorns that they put in His head that were this long. He took all that pain because He was God. Because no human would have survived just the beating that He took. But it was worse than that. Then He carried the cross. They put those thorns in His head. And He did that for us. He did that for us. And you think there's something He won't do for you. Did that for us. How can we not sit here and say, Lord, no matter what you want to do with me, I'm available. What did Isaiah say? Here I am, send I. How can you have something more important in your life than living for Him? How can you? Especially here, we talk about what Jesus has done for us. It's the whole center of my existence. My first Sunday school, he told me, he said, that's going to be what you preach until you come home. What I did for you. He's my testimony. I don't have one. My testimony is all about Him. And what He's done for us. He made us royal children of the Most High God. That's what God accomplished on that cross. Because He went there, you are now dressed in robes and garments of salvation and righteousness. You are now clothed with royalty. All the angels in heaven see you as royal children of God, and they are here to obey the Word. You need to start speaking the Word with authority and power as Jesus gave you. He commanded us to go into all the world and make disciples of all nations. Not by shape, size, nationality, language, or color, because there is none in the book either. These Christians that separate people by color, nationality, and language, shame on them in Jesus' name. Because all who call upon Him shall be saved. We are a body of one with many parts. Amen?
Jesus.
Amen.
Thank you, Jesus.
Amen. You don't need to go there. 1 Thessalonians 1:5. For our gospel did not come to you in word only, but in power and in the Holy Spirit. In much assurance, as you know what kind of men we were among you for your sake, do people know what kind of Christians you are? When you speak, do you speak with power and authority and a conviction in your voice that's going to change the way they think about God? Are they going to see the joy of the Lord is truly your strength? That you walk in peace and love and mercy? Because when you walk in the power that He's given you, you're going to walk with a different step. Oh yeah, He's given me a different walk since I got saved. And people think it's arrogance. They think I'm cocky. No, I'm not. See, I've learned in 25 and a half years how little I am. Not how tall I am. But I've learned the one that lives within me. He's overcome the world. And He said, you walk in a glorious way in me and through me and for my glory only. You're going to see what the glory and the power, how they go together and what's really in you in the next verse we use. Remember something, I walk with a confidence in who He is and what He's made me. It has nothing to do with my accomplishments. It's who the one who accomplished life for me, who gave me eternal life, who set me free from the bonds of hell to walk in the newness of life as a victorious son of God, walking dressed as a royal son of God, walking as a priest and king, having dominion over this earth. I sit in the heavenlies with Christ, and so do you. You need to start speaking and walking different. Your heart should be so happy today knowing who's in you and what he's done for you. Oh, hallelujah.
Thank you, Jesus.
Oh, God is good.
We need more drink.
This is a good one right here. 2 Thessalonians 1, 11 through 12. Remember when I told we did that 5-week series on glory? It's already in you. Everybody's waiting for the glory to manifest. Well, God's waiting for you to give him permission to manifest his glory through you so people can see it. Woo! Yeah! Now we're talking.
Ooh, Jesus.
Now I'm talking. This is good. You're going to like this. Therefore, we also pray always for you that our God would count you worthy of his calling. Stop. You are worthy. Period. End of conversation. The blood of Jesus Christ has made you a worthy priest and a king of the Most High God. Never sit around and go, oh, I'm so unworthy, Lord. That is the biggest bunch of nonsense I've ever heard in my life. God made you worthy to be a priest and a king. He made you worthy. Oh, hallelujah. And fulfill, watch this, the good pleasure of his goodness. And the work of faith with power. That the name of our Lord Jesus Christ may be what? Glorified in you. And you in him. According to the grace of our God and the Lord Jesus Christ. The glory's in us. Jesus has been glorified. He's inside of you. We did a 5-week teaching on the glory of God. It's who he is. He is the glorified king. The glorified king lives in you. He's waiting for you to say, let your glorious power live and emanate out of me this day. Got quiet of God. Why? It's there. It's in you. Take the cap of the bottle off. Please. Say, God, your glory, the glorified Son of God, Father, is already in me. Your glory dwells within me in the form of the Holy Spirit, the fullness of the Godhead. All his glory is in you. You've been endued with it, empowered with it. And the glory will emanate out of you in the power of the resurrected life of his Son. Why do you think he gives you dominion? What Adam and Eve lost, you got back.
Amen.
See, they had to battle their flesh. You don't. You got the one that overcame your flesh living in you. Submit your flesh to the glory and the Spirit of God every morning, and it won't get in your way anymore. Oh, hallelujah. He got on me this last week. He said, you have the spirit of self-control. Now tell some of that food, no. Just saying. I said, it's potluck tomorrow. He said, that's only Sunday. That's your day of rest, rejoicing, fellowshipping in food, and worship and word. You're doing exactly what I've called you to. But potluck is once a month. Once a month. The rest of the time, you do it this way. And we haven't really been changing our diet, the way we do things. It's not a diet, it's a way of living. Don't put pressure on yourself to be on some kind of strict diet and all this other nonsense. Then you're going to be like a lot of people walking around afraid of food. God says, bless everything in his name, and it's holy, and it's good for you. Amen? But don't make your diet of cookies and cakes and pies. Me and John were talking the other day. One of our downfalls is ice cream. Last week I went to the store and I almost went down the aisle and he said, no, you don't. I said, you have self-control. Whoop! Go this way to the vegetable counter. Amen? So I got you that ninja machine for a reason, which we use every day. And it's amazing how much body your better feels. Your temple, what you put in, is what's going to come back out. You put in nutrition that his spirit leads you to. Like I said, I feel better now at my age than I did when I was 20 years old. First of all, now I'm saved. Now I'm filled with Christ. Now I have joy and peace and hope and love and not hatred in my heart anymore. It's amazing how much God changes us. Amen?
Amen.
Amen?
Amen.
Remember, the power that works within you, the work of faith, is his glory inside of you. It's dying to come out and touch somebody.
Yes, Lord.
It's yearning. But he's waiting on you. See, this ain't about me. This is about you. See, I'm just giving you what he gave me to give you, so that is up to you after that. You can't come back and say, I didn't know, because yes, you do. I'm just saying. My first pastor looked me in the eyes one time. I was having some issues when I was a young Christian. He said, you hear the truth in here. You're going to be held accountable to it. And he said it in a way, he's a little guy. He looked up over his glasses. I went, my trouble. You're about to be if you don't change. Once you hear the truth, you're responsible for it. Just saying. Oh, we're having fun. We're just about done. Exodus 14. God's waiting on you. Death and life are in the power of the tongue. Start speaking with the authority that the Son of God gave you. Amen. You have it. You have problems with your flesh and your thinking? Speak to it. You have it. You can command your heart, mind, body, and soul to be obedient to the power of the resurrected life in you, the Holy Ghost. You have the power to look in the mirror and speak to your body and tell it to behave. Yeah. You find yourself being miserable and grumbling and doing and complaining and whatever, because we all do it, and don't say you don't. Well, Melissa doesn't, but the rest of us do sometimes. But the thing is, he's given it to you. Remember, Christ came to give. He didn't come to take. The only thing he takes out of you is the junk that you should be hanging on to anyway.
Amen.
Like that one group that sang that song, take the junk out of the trunk or something. Yeah, that's Christians. He comes in to remove your junk from your trunk, so everything that's left is him. Amen?
Yeah.
Exodus 14.
Verse 13 to 15.
And Moses said to the people, remember something, they're all grumbling. This is so crucial. Now, this is an Old Testament man where you have so much more power than they had. But you know what? See, there, they didn't rely on their power. They relied on God. Moses, Abraham, Isaac, Jacob, all of them, Joseph, all of them, King David, all of them, Daniel, all the prophets. They relied on God. They had no hope in man. They never put confidence in mankind. They knew better. What's our excuse? Because now we know we've got to go to heaven. Heaven lives inside of you and all the power of it. Oh.
Amen.
And Moses said to the people, they're all grumbling, do not be afraid. Stand still and see the salvation of the Lord, which he will accomplish for you today. For the Egyptians whom you see today, you will see again no more forever. You got enemies? Don't worry about them. Pray for them. I'm just saying. God will deal with them. It's not your job. The Lord will fight for you. Man, what a promise. And you shall hold your peace. And the Lord said to Moses, why do you cry to me? See, stop all your crying. Tell the children of Israel to go forward, but lift up your rod, stretch out your hand over the sea, and divide it. And the children of Israel shall go on dry ground through the midst of the sea. Why are you not lifting up your voice and speaking the word of God and speaking at your circumstances? Because they're not your life. Circumstances happen. How you respond is how he responds. But if you speak the word, if you don't speak it with power and authority, and then believe in your heart that it shall be, don't expect your circumstances to change. A lot of times we stay in circumstances because we're spending too much time complaining about them and asking God to change them when he's telling you to speak at them. He told Moses, go divide the sea. Here's a staff, now go. Why are you crying to me? I told you what to do, now go do it. Has he told you what to do and you didn't do it?
Amen.
Amen. Oh, we're having a good time today. We haven't even gotten to the food yet. Thank you, Jesus. You will not see it until you believe it and you speak it with authority. How do you expect God's word to manifest? See, he does. He's the living word. He will watch over his word, which is himself, and he will perform it. Psalm 138. When you have concerns in your life, see, if you spoke the word and you believe that it would come to pass, it says he will perfect all that concerns you. When you have concerns in your life, say, Lord, I thank you thy word is truth, and every man and everything be found a liar. You will perfect that which is concerning me right here, right now. Now, do you trust him that it will happen that way? Or do you go, oh, but this, but that, but this, but that. There's no, those three words, those three letters, don't use them with your God, because it'll nullify God's promises.
Amen.
You'll drag through it, you'll keep dragging. I don't know how many years I was drugged through the mud because I wouldn't change the way I spoke. Father, one time he said, if you'd stop talking about your circumstances, I could fix them.
Hallelujah.
I wasn't trained well yet. No, it's true though. I stayed in some stuff. He said, see this one? See, and he took me back. He said, see what you learned here, learned here. What'd you learn? The longer that you looked at your circumstances instead of me, and you spoke your circumstances instead of the victory that's in my word, guess what? You stayed in it a little longer than you had to. I was trying to teach you this all along. But we are a stubborn human race. And we got to learn the hard way. And all my mentors told me the things I've told people. No, do this, speak this, speak that. I'll get it done. I'm just saying, I'm sharing my own personal shortcomings and weaknesses, okay? Because we all have weaknesses and shortcomings. But I know the overcomer lives in me, and if I had learned to listen better, I wouldn't be in these trials I've gone through so long. Now the trials are a lot quicker and a lot smoother, because now I know he's doing something to make me a better vessel. See, when stuff happens in your life, say, Lord, what am I to learn here? Am I not thinking right? Am I not speaking right? Am I not seeing it right? See, God wants you to take everything to him. How many people have told you, well, God doesn't, he's not worried about all these little details. Heck, he's not. He knows every heartbeat you're going to have today and how many. He knows all your thoughts you're going to have before you go to heaven and every word you're going to speak for your entire life before you have them and speak them. Psalm 139, I'm just saying. Just saying. So, if you got stinking thinking today and you got a problem with your words that you're speaking about your life, it's time to change. Because the spoken word is everything. I'm telling you, death and life are in the power of the tongue. What you speak is what's going to be. Don't go out and be a name it and claim it Christian. I speak the word of God over your lives, over this ministry, over this valley, over this country, over Israel. I speak what God says to speak. I don't go to him with a Christmas wish list, with a bunch of wants. The only thing I really want in life is to fulfill my destiny. And without Christ, I can't possibly do that. Without being submitted and surrendered 100%, that will never happen. Because he won't honor me if I don't completely give it all to him. And that he gets all the praise and honor and glory and credit for everything that's done with my existence. Because without him, I truly am nothing. I have no reason for living unless it's for Christ. I don't. It's taken me 25 and a half years to really come to terms with that and with peace with that. Because it has nothing to do with my abilities, my talents, or who I am. It's who I am in Christ that makes me who I am. And when you get to that place of peace, Jesus, you are my life. You are why I get up every morning. Not your family, not your job, not your money, not your homes, nothing. You're why I get up every morning. You want to have a blessed life? Then you will have a blessed life that he will give you, that he ordained for you before the foundation of the world. Because only in there that the fullness of joy and peace will be your strength. And then the glory will emanate out of you in Jesus' name. Amen?
Amen.
Oh, they're doing the drums okay. That's why I never got them. Oh, the drone. Oh, that little drone. That thing's cool. Who's your role model? Jesus. Jesus spoke some stuff, didn't he? Don't go there. This is what we're going to close with. Just a couple scriptures. I'm going to show you the power of death and life in the tongue. Amen.
Amen.
If you're one with God, you're one with this word, then you're going to speak the way Jesus spoke as he commands you to. You don't have to. And you don't have to, but your life is going to be boring. Your life should be so exciting, people should be chasing you down. How does this work and where did you get this from? They should be chasing you down. Or running from you because they got so many demons and they don't want to get anywhere near you. The demons don't want them getting delivered, amen? Don't go there, you can write them down. Mark 1:41, the man with leprosy. Then Jesus, moved with compassion, stretched out his hand and touched him and said, he spoke, "I am willing, be cleansed." He spoke. He spoke. What happened? He was cleansed. And he touched the man with leprosy. Oh my God. Man, the Pharisees and the Sadducees, when they heard he touched a man with leprosy, they was doing cartwheels. No wonder why they were plotting to kill him early in his journey, okay, when his ministry started. Mark 2, 11-12. This is the paralytic. He said to the paralytic, "I say to you, arise, take up your bed and go to your house." And immediately he arose and took up the bed, went into and went out in the presence of them all, so that they were all amazed and glorified God, saying, "We never saw anything like this." He said to the paralytic, he spoke life, he spoke healing, and that's what you're to be doing. Amen. He spoke it. It happened immediately. Not 3 weeks from now. The word is living and active. It'll be spoken and performed. Expect it to. Do you believe it will? I do. And you should too. Because the promises that a yes and amen in Christ Jesus to me are to you also. I'm not privileged company here. Oh, Dennis, no. You know, when you read the Bible, God loves everybody. He doesn't say promises are yes and amen to me, but to all who call upon his name. See, it's for all of us. It's not for some of us. It's for all of you. You need to learn to start speaking the word.
Amen.
When God brings you somebody that's sick and not feeling good, speak life. Prophesy to them out of the word. The word says, you were healed at the cross over 2,000 years ago. I speak to those legs to be restored, those lungs to be restored, those eyes and ears to be restored. You can see, you can hear, you can walk. You will live and be satisfied with a long life. Start speaking life into other people's lives, and then your life will change. Because now you're no longer you-centered, but Christ-centered. Ooh. You want to see results in your prayer life? Believe what you say. See, I believe when I pray for someone, God's going to do it. You know why? Because he can't lie. See, it's not rocket science. It's simple. God says, speak. Go into all the world and preach the word. And these signs will accompany you. The blind will see. The lame will walk. The deaf will be here. Demons will be cast out.
Amen.
He spent as much time casting out demons as he did healing. He talks about it all the time. The deaf and mute boy that was thrown on the floor and in the fire, foaming at the mouth. Bam, it was gone. Speak the word of God with power and authority today in Jesus' name.
Jesus.
Amen. God, I'm having a good time today. John 9, the man born blind. First, he rebuked them all because they said, who sinned, this or him or his parents? He said, nobody sinned, but that the works of God, the word, be glorified, magnified in this man. He said, this is what he was, I allowed it so that you're going to see when the spoken word touches somebody. And what happened? Go wash in the pool of Siloam, and he came back seeing. See, when God tells you to go do something, the guy's probably going, go wash in the pool, what the heck? That word Siloam means sent. When you look it up in the Bible dictionary, it's sent. So he went and washed, he came back perfectly seeing, born blind. God spoke. Go wash your eyes in that little pool over there and come on back. Came back 20/20 vision, how about that? He spoke. He spoke. See, so I'm showing you just some of the miracles because he spoke them. He is the word. And when you speak the word, it'll do the same thing it did for Jesus. John 11, Jesus spoke and said, Lazarus, come forth. Roll that stone away. Oh, it's going to stink when you open that. No, it didn't. No, it didn't. When I get to heaven, I'm going to ask him, what was going on with you and the Lord when you was in that thing? There was something going on in there. Because he came walking right out. I bet he was skipping. Jesus said, take them grave clothes off. He's not dead, but alive. He spoke life, not death.
Amen.
The blind saw, the lame walked, the deaf heard, eyes were opened, demons came out, the dead were raised. The woman with the son in the casket walks over, touches the casket, and said, I say to you, young man, arise. Life came back. Speak the word with belief and authority that Christ gave you. He gave us all the same measure of faith.
Jesus.
The more you speak it, the more it'll come alive. The more you meditate on it, the more you'll speak it, walk it out, and live it. The more you praise Him, the more He's going to glorify you in Him. It says He gets glorified by the glory coming out of you. In power. It says in Thessalonians, in power. Talks about power a lot in the Bible. Oh, hallelujah. Hallelujah. Telling you, where you walk the ground, you tremble.
Amen.
Do you realize that? When they prayed in the book of Acts, what happened when they worshiped God? The ground shook. The whole ground shook under everybody's feet.
Lord,
oh, and they were all filled with the Holy Ghost and praised God. And then they asked for more boldness.
Yeah.
They're all getting threatened with prison and death. What did they say? Oh, let us have more boldness, oh God. Knowing it was probably going to lead to a dungeon or a cross. What happened, church? God's waiting on us.
Amen.
He's not waiting on Him. He's waiting on the church. Amen?
Amen. Thank you, Jesus.
I know the kids in the back are probably getting restless for food. I know them too well. I went back there before I asked the two older ones. I said, Connor, taking it easy on you? Can you handle them? Connor thought I was back there for them. I asked about him. He's a young man of God. He's ready to go. Amen?
Thank you, Lord.
Made it all the way through without unbuttoning the shirt. That was pretty good. Jesus, Jesus, Jesus. To bless you, to refresh you. He's empowered you. He's called you to a higher place with Him now. Look unto Him and Him alone, and He shall supply. Look unto Him alone, and He shall strengthen thy heart and thy mind and thy soul. Let Him restore your wounded heart this day. Let Him come and touch you and have His way with you. Stop thinking what you think, because it's not what He thinks of you. What He thinks of you are pure and holy and righteous thoughts. He cherishes you. You are a chosen generation, precious in the sight of Almighty God. Let Him pour that river of life on you now and wash away all that's old and bring in a whole new future for you. Stop looking back and start looking forward. It's not about what the world has done or said or what it's doing. It's about what God has called you to. Now let go of you today and let the fullness of the river of life that He wants to pour down to heaven right now onto you and in you. And Father, I pray a blessing upon everybody in here now. In Jesus' name, of grace and peace and a fresh anointing of that living river that flows right down the middle of heaven. The Holy Ghost of joy and peace and strength, refreshing and nourishing and healing and blessings upon everybody here now in the name of Jesus. I say it is so in the name of Jesus. Lord, what we decree and declare, it is and it will be done. Come and set us free from ourselves so that You can have Your way with us, O God. Let it go. Glory shine out of us today, Father, in the holy and the mighty name of Jesus. Amen.